Hey everyone, this is Dr. Nick, and I'm really excited to do a video reply to Dr. Eric Berg, How to Fix a Broken Metabolism. He shares a lot of great facts. There's a few things, though, I want you to be aware of because it's absolutely essential for you to accomplish your goal. Which is your goal? Have great energy, look great, and feel great. So let's go ahead and take a look at what Dr. Berg has to say about how to fix metabolism.
Now, it's number one. The facts about the metabolism is that when you go on a diet, you will slow your metabolism. So dieting slows your metabolism. If you've dieted for many, many years, then your metabolism is very, very slow. If you've never dieted, then your metabolism is probably a lot faster, okay? So dieting also increases hunger and cravings. If you ever look at the show The Biggest Loser, they always make it look so, you know, like dramatic, like how can they lose all that weight? But what happens when these guys start losing, they start slowing down and slowing down where it's really, really tough until they have to exercise so hard to get off that last bit of weight. It's crazy. And then they don't show, they have to sign a waiver. Many of these people gain the weight right back, okay? And I'll tell you why in a second.
So first he says dieting slows metabolism. And certainly that's true. What you need to be aware of is that not only your rate at which you burn calories, or in other words, metabolism is the rate at which you consume or burn calories and use up hopefully fat rather than body protein, certainly some glucose is used up. But there's a very critical factor that I'm going to share with you over the course of this video, and I want you to stay tuned because it's so important to know this. Next, he shares about that the world's greatest loser, that these individuals basically lose the weight, and that last part is very hard to lose the weight. And most of them starve themselves. They go on water, just water only or Jell-O only. I've read up on some of these people, how they lost weight. And he's right, Dr. Berg, they do gain the weight back and with a vengeance. And again, not only is it a metabolism issue and a hormone issue, but there's this other factor that's so critical to understand. Let's continue what he has to say.
So also, age slows your metabolism. Surprise, you're probably already finding it out. So exercise will increase hunger and cravings too with some people, but mainly hunger because you're burning stuff up, you're gonna want more.
Okay, he says age slows metabolism. He's right. As we get older, you know, we're basically probably less active, our hormone levels are declining, we burn less calories, we burn less fat. Everyone sees this. As they get older, they gain more fat, particularly in the belly or the hips or the thighs, depending on whether you're a man or a woman, or your genetics, where the fat distributes. I'll never forget a story of Colleen where she had this pear shape, where she was kind of slender at the top, and when it got down to her hips and thighs, very, very large. And her goal was, when she came to see me, was to transform that pear shape. And I said, I'm not sure we could do this. This is almost 30 years ago when I first wrote the book, Weight Loss and Energy Now. And I put her on the 10 steps in this book, and I now have posted it in the show notes as a link to the steps that are so successful. And it's interesting that over the course of a year, initially, yes, she lost weight, particularly first in the leaner areas. Ironically, that's where people lose the weight first instead of the heaviest areas. But the good news is over the course of past 1 year, because it was so easy to stay on the Delgado protocol that I taught her, she wasn't hungry, she followed the steps, she did exactly what I said, but she got rid of that pear shape. I wasn't even expecting that. She could fit in the designer jeans. Her name's Colleen, and she continued on the program for more than 30 years. I haven't caught up to her recently. Maybe I can find her here and update you as to how she's doing. But it was a fabulous example. Plus, she was in a hospital cafeteria, so she had a lot of temptations of the foods that I had encouraged her to not eat, but also I gave her a full list of the food she could eat. And of course, I wanted her to exercise, and she did. She didn't do excessive exercise. Now, I have a comment. Now, Berg says exercise increases hunger and increases cravings. Maybe initially that's true, but think about exercise. Over the course of time, The great book written by Covert Bailey, Fit or Fat, showed that you become very efficient at burning fat, but somewhere past 6, 7, 8 months. So that's partly why Colleen was so successful. She stuck with my recommendations. She did her daily simple 30 minutes to an hour and a half, depending on whether she had time to walk that distance or run or play or work out with weights, but an hour and a half, but a minimum of 30 minutes a day. And I said, do it 7 days a week because human nature, you're gonna miss a day or two. And she ended up doing a net average of 4 workouts a week, which was enough to completely redesign her body and do it for a lifetime. Isn't that the best success? Because world's greatest loser, so what? You lose 200-300 pounds, but gain it back? And then worse, you tend to gain it back more so every time you try and diet. That's what Berg is concerned about, and so am I. So let's continue.
And the last thing is, it's very unnatural to lose weight. Very unnatural. Losing weight is anti-survival because fat is a survival mechanism. So when you try to lose it, it goes against the survival. So really, we need to dive in, like, the understanding of what that is so we can undo it. But we're talking really about your set point. And the set point is the point at which your body very likes to be weight-wise. It just settles into the certain point. It doesn't like to go below that. It might not even go higher than that, but it likes to settle down at a certain point. So my goal is to help you in this video show you how to lower that set point. So for example, let's say your set point is 182 and you want to get to 142. So we need to drop the set point, and that's really the metabolism point where your body kind of settles into. It likes to, the body just likes to be the same. It doesn't like to go down too much because that's starvation, right? So what we want to do is give you the next part of this, a foundation of how we're going to fix the set point. But first we have to talk about what destroys the set point.
Okay, so he makes a great point that the body tends to want to stay at a set point. If you weigh 220 pounds and you drop down to 140 pounds, your goal weight, your body wants to struggle to get back to that higher body weight, that set point. But here's the fact that he's not alluding to or explaining, even though I don't know, he may or may not know this, but metabolism is the rate at which you burn calories, right? The rate at which you burn fat, particularly, hopefully, and again, preserving your body protein, maintaining what's called a protein sparing effect. And he wants to do it by tricking the glucose, that is burning up the blood sugar first, then he wants you to burn the fat primarily. So we'll talk about that in a moment. But here's the key hidden fact that I said I would allude to, and I'm gonna drop this bomb right now, and I'll explain it in more detail at the end of this video. You see, people are genetically born with a certain number of fat cells. The average person is born with about 30 billion fat cells, which means that's about 37 pounds of body fat. And the body will tend to be a little bit leaner when you're one of those people born with about 30 billion fat cells. However, other people can be born with 100 billion fat cells. And literally, they can get 3 times fatter because they have more fat stored cells. And those people who are massively obese could be born with 300 billion fat cells, which the net result means is that you have the storage capacity of, in the case of 100 billion fat cells, you can store somewhere over 100 pounds of body fat. Well, most people never need that much body fat, even to sire a child, to have a baby, go through pregnancy, to go through exercise or long journeys. But in some cases, that was a survival mechanism. But those with 300 billion fat cells could essentially store somewhere approaching over 300 pounds of body fat, and your body will struggle to maintain the number of fat cells. And I'm going to make a comment about liposurgery right now because you need to hear this. So many men and women run out and go to a surgeon and do liposuction. I had a good friend that worked for a plastic surgeon, and she said, I don't need to follow any kind of a diet. I'm just going to go ahead and have lipo. And I said, okay, but you really need to understand the principles of healthy eating, exercise, lifestyle to keep that weight off, even if you use lipo. Well, she ignored me, and she basically just, of course, went and saw her surgeon, and she honestly, she looked great. She looked absolutely fabulous after the surgeon got done with her. But as the facts come about, by the end of over I think it was 3 years. But within a year, she was gaining the weight back because, trust me, she hadn't changed a thing about her diet. And I had beliefs about her diet. I thought it could have been far better. Bottom line is, by the end of 3 years, she had gained not only the weight she had lost from lipo, she had gained back more. I don't want to be cruel, but you remember in Ghostbusters, the Pillsbury Marshmallow Man? What was he called? The Doughboy? Everything was just stretching out. Even though the surgery lines were there, all the fat was bulging out from her body. It was just a really difficult thing for her. I know, because I used to be terribly overweight all the way up till 12 years old, and then even more weight when I tried to lose weight for football and then gained it back from starving, and gained it because I was so, like, felt so deprived, and I gained to play football, and I went up to over 220 pounds, and then I had a struggle to lose that weight. It wasn't until I learned the secrets I'm going to share with you that are well described on my website and on our special course, Fat Loss and Fitness. But let's go back, because I think this story is absolutely essential. I'm really passionate about the subject because I'm looking to help you with a permanent solution to fat loss and metabolism. Because when you do lipo, it gets rid of the fat cells that are there. But guess what? Your body can produce new fat cells back up to the genetic predisposition or whatever number of fat cells you originally had. Can you imagine that? Even surgery doesn't get rid of them permanently. Even ask Dr. Garth Davis, who wrote the book Proteinaholics, and he's a plastic surgeon. He knows all about surgical interventions for fat loss and the different methods. And he said, until they change their lifestyle and went to a low protein, high fiber, complex carbohydrate, plant-based diet, that's when he started seeing the great results. Because he used to give them a fact sheet of diet, and it centered around a protein diet, because that's what everyone thinks is you need protein to lose weight or you need fat to lose weight. But let's go on.
Beyond just dieting, okay? So let me show you that. Okay, so here's what you need to know. Number one, you have this thing called the pancreas. It's located underneath your left rib cage, and the pancreas has about a million islands of cells, okay? And there's these little tiny, it looks like little ions, islands in a bunch of tissue, and they call it islands of Langerhans after the guy's name who discovered it. But there's different cells, and they're called alpha, beta, delta cells. The beta cells are the ones that we're gonna talk about first. And 60% of those cells are beta cells, okay? And the other 40% are other cells. Now, what is beta cells? The beta cells make insulin, okay? So that's what they do. So insulin is most known for regulating sugar, right, and carbohydrates. So what insulin does is it lowers the sugar in the blood, okay? So that's what you need to, I'm going to kind of build on this, but you need to understand that. So insulin lowers the sugar, but the other thing is that insulin also has other functions that a lot of people don't realize. Number one, it affects fat metabolism. It affects protein metabolism, okay? So it converts sugar into cholesterol. It converts sugar into triglycerides. Those are blood fats. It basically increases the tension on the arteries, increasing blood pressure. It retains sodium, okay? It drives protein or amino acids into the cells. And and we'll get more into that in a bit, but I wanted just to have you understand that protein, insulin has a lot more to do just in carbohydrate metabolism. But for your viewpoint, what you need to know right now is that it's the thing that makes fat. It's the primary regulator that makes you fat, and it actually blocks any chance of burning fat. In the presence of a little bit of insulin, you're not going to burn fat, period, okay?
Okay, so Dr. Berg made a big point, specifically from Guyton's Medical Physiology, which if you look up the sections, which I always earmark and I read these massive textbooks, I really like Dr. Berg. He's really good, he's smooth, he's a nice, gentle presenter, and here I'm get all excitable, and you know that's just my nature. But if you look through Guyton's Medical Physiology, and there's a section on insulin and adrenal cortical hormones, specifically about cortisol. On one point he makes is page 1025. And there's some other areas here that I want you to understand in great appreciation of how the fat and the triglycerides and these things all enter into play on probably one of the toughest things to understand for any doctor, scientist, educator, health educator, because fat, being obese, I know what it was like. And so some people who have never been overweight, they can't quite understand what you and I have suffered through. And I gotta tell you, it was embarrassing when I was young and really overweight and just felt self-conscious about it. And I remember there was jokes made about me, about Omar the tent maker, that I didn't know what they meant, but later I understood that I wore extra husky jeans because they were so large because I had gotten so heavy. But to really now understand this whole complex issue, it's just something I want you to understand. So it's true, insulin plays a big role in the control of fat retention, and it may tend to block the ability of the body to burn fat. But the truth is, insulin-like growth factor and cortisol can be enhanced. That is, there's certain effective techniques and supplements that we can do for adrenal support to get the fat into the fat cells to be burned properly. So don't be intimidated that this insulin is somehow the be-all and end-all. It's one part of the puzzle. I really want you to understand it is a rather complex puzzle, but once we put all the parts together, his title, How to Fix a Broken Metabolism, will make sense, but in a more eloquent and simple way. And again, I'm not trying to be arrogant. I get comments of people whenever another scientist or educator's commenting on another, but I really, out of the deepest of my heart, respect the work that Berg's doing, and I want you to get to the next level so you have a permanent solution, not a temporary solution. So let's carry on.
This is out of guidance physiology, and this is a known fact. So it'll make you fat and blocks the release of fat. Okay, so we have insulin that is triggered by a high carbohydrate meal. You probably already know that. You eat some bread, you increase sugar, and what happens, your body will store that into a stored sugar called glycogen.
Okay, first he says insulin is triggered by a high carbohydrate meal, and then it will store the glucose in the form of glycogen, either in the liver and in the muscles, and a little bit blood sugar circulating in the general circulation. But you have to be clear what Dr. Berg is saying. He's confused because the original studies by Dr. Fredrickson that I looked up of the National Institute of Health, when they did the studies on carbohydrates increasing insulin and blood sugar level, it was based on simple and complex carbohydrates mixed together. And of course, bread, it could be white bread. They made no distinguishing between whole fiber sprouted bread. Not that I'm advocating bread because a lot of people have gluten issues, but the point is carbohydrates are not the bad guy. In fact, complex carbohydrates, vegetables and fruit and potatoes and tubers, so long as they're prepared without oil, will not spike insulin whatsoever. I can show you my own blood tests eating high starch, whole complex carbohydrates. I can show you hundreds of my clients. Insulin stabilizes in the low twos, 2 to 3. When I start seeing 5 and above, it's starting to get a little high, 10, 20, I see high insulin levels. I even do my blood test sometimes after eating, not even fasting, and come in with good insulin levels. And again, I'm not trying to be arrogant, I'm just saying I, as a subject of one and one, but thousands of people that I've monitored over the years, tens of thousands of people since I wrote the original book, Weight Loss and Energy Now, back in 1991. And the principles I taught here are still correct. And now in my coaching program, I've updated them and added a whole new host of information. So what I'm saying is we can control the metabolism, and it's not just fat that will stabilize insulin. He's gonna build a case for that right now. Let's hear what he says.
So glycogen is a series of glucose molecules stuck together. Okay, it needs potassium to be stored. So we got stored sugar, and then anything excess, it turns into fat. Okay, so we have a combination of stored sugar, and fat. Okay, that's what insulin does.
Okay, he says we have a combination of stored sugar and fat, and sugar can turn into fat. Sugar, glucose, and glycogen is a very clean fuel and likes to remain in that form and can be converted and burned effectively through obviously exercise and modulating the amount of total animal protein versus plant protein foods. I don't want you to get the feeling that the moment you eat fruit or a potato that quote starch or the fructose sugar turns into fat. It doesn't, because it has polyphenols that stabilize its insulin. That's come out in several recent medical journals. So it's your friend to eat fresh fruits and vegetables and potatoes. It doesn't make sense to have to consume fat to somehow control insulin. Let's go further.
And so what happens though with a lot of people is they start getting a fatty liver. So it's really the insulin that makes the fatty liver, especially if the person is not consuming alcohol, all right? And then insulin, if gone on too far, will destroy proteins. Yeah, muscle wasting, all the, I mean, think about what part of your body is protein. You got intracellular proteins, you have like so many different proteins. Your body is gonna waste those and it's gonna convert those into sugar, and it's going to leave carbon skeletons. So it's just basically going to leave the waste, and it's going to convert everything else to sugar. And basically, that's what destroys a diabetic, is that they get clogged arteries, a stroke, they have their kidneys fail, and then they have protein destruction. That's why they usually have protein coming out of the kidneys, and they destroy that. And so you have everything that kind of spills off into the rest of the tissue. So it's a very ugly, destructive disorder.
Well, let's unwind that. That's really important to understand. Dr. Berg's right, alcoholism can cause a fatty liver, but he's making a case for those people who don't consume alcohol, yet still have a fatty liver. Guess what? The highest incidence of fatty liver is not in cultures living around the world where they eat a lot of fresh fruits and vegetables and plant-based proteins. In fact, their livers are immaculate. It's in Western world where they eat a lot of fat and meat and cheese and eggs. Fat turns into a fat disorder which cannot be metabolized effectively, and that very fat, 37% of the fat, goes right to the fat storage cells, and it also tends to affect the liver. And one of the most common causes of liver failure and kidney renal failure is a very high protein animal-centered diet. We're the Western world. It's not popular for me to say this. There's lobbyists in the government that are pushing the meat, cheese, eggs, and dairy product. There's marketers pushing this because it's easy to stick with a diet you're already used to. I'm teaching a diet that was based on our ancestors, based on the healthiest approach, based on the healthiest cultures in the world, based on the blue zones. The people around the world, Seventh-day Adventists who live in a stressful environment like ours, eat a very high plant-based whole foods diet. The smartest individuals go on an oil-free plant-based diet, and those do the best, and that's the way to avoid a fatty liver. So let's go further, because diabetes itself is not caused by whole natural complex carbohydrates. Indeed, Dr. Kempner proved a rice fruit diet over a course of a year helped people lose over 130 pounds and helped stabilize their blood sugar and help reverse diabetes and reverse cardiovascular disease. So we know this works, there's no doubt about it. And we don't have to restrict you to just rice and fruit, because that's for people who had kidney disorders. They had to go on a low protein diet because rice and fruit has the least amount of protein. But people can eat a wide variety of vegetables, soups, salads. Let's go further, because we're onto something here and I want you to get this clear.
And then what happens normally, this is supposed to happen, is before a meal, you should have a blood sugar between, let's say, 75 and 90. Like, it's say 80 and 90, okay? But normal, also, it can go up to 100. So let's say between 80 and 100. That's normal before you eat, okay? What happens, though, when you eat, the blood sugar should normally spike up to like 120. It can even go up to like 140 after a meal, okay? But the closer you get to 140, the more you're becoming a problem. So if it's above 140, then you become more diabetic, because of diabetes, you have this spike in sugar because the insulin's not there to keep it in check. So it's out of control. So what happens normally is you eat, it kind of spikes to 120, and then it comes back down to normal after 2 to 3 hours. That's normal because the insulin controls that blood sugar. But in a diabetic situation, it raises too high, out of control, you get tired, brain fog, and then it takes a long time to come back and reset. Okay? So now let's go on to the next part.
Okay, so he made a very important point that you need to get, again, a little bit more detail. He's saying that when people eat, and the blood sugar normally can go up to 100, 120. When it gets over 140, that's a danger zone. And he's right about that. You don't want too high of a blood sugar level. And the reason is not due to lack of insulin. Diabetics type 2 particularly produce all the insulin they need. That's been proven time and time again in medical journal studies. The insulin itself, though, is desensitized, ironically, from eating too much oils and fats. The fats have a very harmful effect on insulin, and they cause the insulin to become inefficient, and so the insulin can't push the sugar into the cells, so you get sugar diabetes. The sugar ends up floating around in the bloodstream, comes out on the urine, shows up in various tissues. It's a problem. But the solution, it seems almost counterintuitive. Why would I want to eat a fruit and a vegetable and a potato that has a starch that breaks down into glucose, carbohydrate? Because the body was designed with 32 feet of intestines to handle large fibrous meals and break it down at 2 calories per minute, and then allow the insulin to just push whatever glucose it needed to without having to go too high, the blood sugar maintains optimum levels. Watch my video on is olive oil healthy? It's a little bit lengthy, about 30 minutes, but it'll break it down so clearly to you with the help of Dr. Michael Clapper and my own work showing on a microscope and in blood levels and how I created diabetes in myself with my blood sugar spiking after just drinking oil and eating some meat and cheese, and you can just see my levels spike. When if I just ate in front of you, and I have a microscope in the next coming demonstrations, where if I eat rice or fruit or vegetables throughout the day, blood sugar never spikes that high. It stays nice and even. The polyphenols stabilize the insulin. The blood sugar gets pushed in the cell so long as I don't overeat. But you shouldn't overeat anything, whether it be animal product or too much plant-based foods. But let's go a little bit further, because now we're into the crux of this matter.
High insulin over time or plus time equals insulin resistance. Now, a good analogy would be, let's say you live underneath a train track and there's a train that goes over your house, and you live like there's like a metro or something, and at first you can't sleep because it's so noisy, but over time you become desensitized. You don't hear it anymore because you get used to it. So same thing, being exposed to an antibiotic, you become antibiotic resistant. Okay, so when you have too much of a hormone, especially insulin, the receptor that's supposed to receive that hormone gets altered. It compensates, it downgrades, so it doesn't absorb it. So basically, your body's trying to reject insulin because it's too high, okay? So what causes insulin resistance is too much insulin, okay? So you have a situation where you have too much insulin, but you also have not enough insulin in certain places of your body, like in the cells and in the blood. But we have too much insulin other places. So you could have symptoms of both hyper and hypoglycemia. Interesting. So let's go through the symptoms. Fatty liver, okay? If you have a fatty liver, you have insulin resistance. If you have insulin resistance, you have a fatty liver, because one thing will also cause another. Because some of the fat in the liver actually releases certain inflammatory responses that make you insulin resistant. So it's really a nasty, double-edged sword. Brain fog, okay? High fasting insulin. So even when you're not eating sugar, the insulin is still high in certain places of your body. Remember, insulin blocks fat burning? Okay, belly fat, bloating, digestive issues, sleepy after a meal. Like, say you eat lunch and you have to take a nap, that's classic insulin resistance. High blood pressure. Why? Because insulin causes tension within the arteries. Cravings and hunger. Well, wait a second. That's a low insulin situation, but it's an insulin resistant symptom, but it's really certain parts of your body have a low insulin because the cell won't let it kind of connect. So you're basically craving and hungry all the time. Dark pigment in your folds, in different folds of your body, like your groin, your armpits, your neck, you have a little darker pigmentation. That can happen in advanced stages. And hunger between meals. So you can't go a long period of time without getting hungry or having a blood sugar issue. That's insulin resistance. So insulin resistance is the single biggest problem for that controls your set point. It destroys your set point, okay? Why? Because insulin is the hormone that tells your body whether to burn fat or not, okay? It's gonna become more clear as we go through the next part too. So insulin increases fat, prevents the burning of fat, and controls and destroys your set point. Other than that, it's perfectly fine.
Okay. So he went through a very clear explanation of insulin resistance, and he talks about the fatty liver, the brain fog, the fasting insulin levels, how they're elevated, the whole changes of cravings and blood pressure and hunger. And by the way, the dark areas in the folds of the skin, that's usually another hormone called ACTH, and that relates to a cortisol level issue as well. It's not just about insulin. But what he's trying to say is that this problem with insulin, this insulin resistance, makes it virtually impossible to reach a good set point or a good body weight until you manage insulin. He's partially right. I would agree. Insulin needs to be managed, but not in the way he's about to describe. So let's go further because you need to hear the full story. Please, please stay with me. This is so important.
Let me show you the next part. Okay, so now the big question is, what causes insulin resistance, okay? High insulin, but what causes insulin? The spike, right? You already know it's sugar, but there's some other things that will increase insulin as well. And that would be protein. Some types of protein more than others, okay? And what I'm talking about is see, protein doesn't trigger glucose. So you probably heard of the glycemic index, right? Well, that's the level of the foods that trigger the sugars. But have you ever heard of the insulin index? Completely different. Okay, I'm going to talk about that in the next section. But the point is there are other factors that will increase insulin that don't increase glucose. This explains why you probably are eating healthy, no sugars, and you're still not losing weight.
Okay, so he makes an important point here. He says you could be avoiding sugars, but not able to lose weight. And that's a correct statement, because sugar itself is not the cause of insulin resistance, although he's not gonna say that. He's gonna say it has more to do with fat and the control of insulin, but let's talk about that a moment. Here's on a particular individual that has an insulin level, and he didn't eat in the morning. He had his blood test around 4 o'clock in the afternoon. He tends to at times stay up late and then kind of not eat his morning meal because he's kind of doing that intermittent fasting a little bit. And his blood insulin level is 5.8. I can take a snapshot and zero in a little bit closer. Just remember that number, 5.8, which is the insulin level. And usually insulin is measured like on a fasting, but I'll do a postprandial, like after eating, and want to see where the insulin and blood sugar levels get to, because you really learn quite a bit about that. Also, by the way, his triglycerides were 118, his cholesterol 138, his LDL 75, let's see, of other importance, his testosterone level 827. Now, this individual had a non-fasting blood sugar level. It went up to 113, and I'll zero in on it if you have any questions about that. Also, because it was non-fasting, I wanted to just get a quick snapshot of the insulin level, and the insulin level is 4.3. In the middle of the day, after eating a light breakfast, lunch, you know, based on as one is hungry, not overeating or not undereating either. But it was the choice of the foods, and it was like fruit, vegetables, a little bit of soaked nuts and seeds and that type of thing, because there was a lot of fiber present. And let's see, in this test, the testosterone level is 875, and there's some other levels to comment on. The cortisol level of, let's see, 7.9 with the morning, afternoon range, that's within range. So this is really important. I want you to get your doctor, if you can, to get your blood test on fasting for blood sugar and insulin and triglycerides, because those are the three most important tests to start monitoring. And then go in after your typical meal, whether it be keto, paleo, plant-based oil-free, which is where I want you to test out in comparison, and you will be shocked. I guarantee, I will assure you, you're going to see over the course of 30 days, if you do plant-based oil-free compared to keto, compared to the Western diet, fasting against, say, 3 hours after eating, you're going to be astonished how incredibly good your blood insulin and glucose level will become on a plant-based, oil-free, unprocessed foods diet. That's going to be actually your solution. And we'll go further here, because he's also saying how protein can throw off insulin. And he's saying how proteins can be digested and turned into sugar. And that is true. The body will not burn fat first. It'll burn protein and body proteins and protein skeletons and enzymes far before it gets around to burning fat, because fat is not the preferred energy the body wants to burn. It holds on to fat. You know that. If you're overweight, it holds on to fat for dear life. It could be the last thing you lose. And it is usually the last thing you lose. But I want this to be simple for you. So let's go a little further. We're getting close to the secret of permanent fat loss. This is what I teach tens of thousands of people successfully.
Now, before you freak out and say, hey, I have to give up protein, hear me out, okay? Because there's some other solutions. But the point is that, especially if you're eating a large amount of proteins, but protein does trigger insulin to some degree.
Okay, so he says, if you eat large amounts of proteins, to some degree, it triggers insulin, which affects negatively sugar levels, but also protein, high protein, particularly animal foods, are high in fat. Let's be clear about this. Okay, let's go a little further.
If we look at the different types of proteins, well, let me just say that to the next one. But gastrointestinal hormones, what does that mean? It means that there are hormones in your GI tract that also increase insulin. So really, every time you eat, you increase insulin, okay? So there's a couple of foods that don't increase insulin. I'll get into that next section. But the point I'm trying to make is that there's other things that are messing you up other than just the sugar.
Okay, so he's saying that just eating triggers insulin and there's various hormones that affect it. And I will agree with him. Again, you're going to need to know this very clearly. What you eat, certainly the amount of food that you eat, but you'll be surprised how much volumes of food you can eat when you get to the plant-based oil-free foods, how effectively your body is accustomed to operating like the best machine. Think of the best car you've ever wanted, a Ferrari or a Lamborghini or whatever, or a Tesla that runs on electricity. These cars have to have a certain fuel. But if you put the wrong fuel in, they'll never run properly. They'll always be in the shop broken down. So let's get to the subject, how to fix a broken metabolism, because you don't want your car fixed is the analogy. You want your car to run absolutely properly. And now he's gonna get to the next most important hormone, which is estrogen, one of my most important topics that I love to share with people because it's such a factor in fat retention.
Estrogen increases insulin as well, yeah. That explains why women, when they get pregnant, they go through the menstrual cycle, they get fatter, okay? Especially if the estrogen is too high. So,
okay, so he says when women get pregnant or they go through the menstrual cycle and as the estrogen levels go up, they get fatter, was his exact words. But it could be that you're not pregnant and you could be a woman or not. A man by the age of 50 has more estrogen than a menstruating female age 22. And how does a man get man boobs and a big belly? He has excess estrogen levels. So there's some certain things that we're going to encourage you to eat, and I think Berg's on track with this estrogen dominance issue, but let's go further.
So we're going to talk about the insulin index in the next section. All right, now check this out. This is the insulin index, okay? Very different than the glycemic index for the most part.
Okay, so he's about to explain the insulin index as contrasted to the glycemic index. But I want to preface one thing so you know this very clearly. If on the glycemic index, Dr. James Anderson, a world-renowned endocrinologist out of the University of Kentucky, if he's still living, he's quite old or he's passed on since, because this was in the late 1970s when I knew Nathan Pritikin. But what he did was he put people recognizing that the typical Western diet led to insulin resistance and high blood sugar levels when you fed individual foods when you were trying to determine what the glycemic index was. Like even carrots spiked insulin level of all things, which is ridiculous. So he put people for 2 weeks on an oil-free, plant-based, bean, fruit, vegetable diet for 2 weeks. And then he did the glycemic index where he measured carrots and he measured bread and he measured each food. And guess what? The glycemic index was completely different than everyone's been led to believe. And meaning that carrots responded perfectly. Fruits and vegetables did not have a spike in insulin. So if you're taking out of context and you're on a Western diet or a keto diet, and then you go ahead and you measure your insulin or glucose like I'm encouraging you to do, and you take an isolated food such as fruit, you say, oh, see, Nick, it spiked my insulin, spiked my blood sugar level. Yeah, but that's because your chemistry is thrown off. You have so much fat that's desensitized your insulin, it's never gonna work properly unless you go for a 2 week cleansing period. And we did this at the Tony Robbins event, and I wrote about this in my book where we tested 893 people at the big Tony Robbins event, and we put them all on a whole foods diet. This was the cookbook that we gave them, how to look great and feel sexy in the buffet style, and they all ate that way for 2 weeks, a little under 10 days actually, 9 days, and their blood sugar levels improved, their triglycerides improved, their energy went through the roof, and their glycemic index, if we were to measure it in a scientific study, was immaculate. But let's see what Berg has to say, because he's about to recommend foods that I would never suggest people use to manage or improve metabolism related specifically to insulin and fat retention.
But look at butter. It's 2%. It's very, very low. It barely triggers insulin at all, just slightly, okay? Olive oil, 3%. Coconut oil, 3%. So really, all the fats are, there's no stimulation. And this is why you can get away with eating the fat.
Okay, so he's saying there's no stimulation from butter, only 2%. Olive oil, 3%. Coconut oil, 3%. Heavy cream, 4%. He's got it all wrong. Watch my video, Is Olive Oil Safe? And it's a takeoff on a video reply that I did on Dr. Axe, who wrote the book, The Keto Diet. And I think you're gonna find this rather revealing because we're getting to the crux of the whole problem. And he's gonna go on to say that pecans, which I think are better for you because it has the fiber intact, but every oil he mentioned, the butter, the olive oil, the coconut oil, the heavy cream, have no fiber in it whatsoever. Fiber plays a big role in insulin and glucose metabolism, which we've learned that on high fiber, unprocessed foods diet, published by the world-renowned Dr. James Anderson, and in the show notes, I can show you all these references if you're curious, if you really want to know the truth and don't get kind of fanatical. People get really upset when we talk about diet, almost like protecting it like it's a religion, but just let it go and listen to the science. Berg is a cool dude. I like what he's teaching, and yet we've got to update your knowledge to get to that next level. So here we go.
More than going low fat, because watch what happens as we go up the scale, we have low-fat yogurt, 76%.
Okay, so he says, rather than going low-fat, that won't solve this. But then he points to low-fat yogurt, and he says 76% insulin metabolism. First off, low-fat yogurt, it's a milk protein, which is highly allergic producing. We know that type 1 diabetics have been now shown to have pancreatic damage. They can't produce insulin properly, oftentimes because of a type of foreign protein insult to the pancreas that caused early damage. So I agree, don't go on low-fat yogurt. Don't go on non-fat yogurt. Don't go on yogurt at all. Yogurt should be, if you're gonna eat it at all, would be like coconut yogurt, almond yogurt, because the dairy itself is highly damaging to the metabolism, particularly dangerous to the pancreas. And that is well described by Dr. Neil Barnard and other videos that I'd be happy to share with you. If you just look up Neil Barnard, MD, and type in about the cause of diabetes type 1 particularly, and Dr. John McDougall and their findings in the medical literature. This is well described, and also well described by Dr. Michael Greger, who his team review over 2,500 medical journals per month, and it's all published on his amazing website. But let's go further, okay?
So when you go low fat cheese, we get rid of the buffer for the insulin, and the protein is higher, and you get more insulin. So all these low-fat things at the store are creating insulin problems.
Okay, so he's saying all these low-fat items at the store are causing insulin problems. You get rid of the buffer, which he's alluding to, that the buffer is fat. It's not because of that. He's trying to play a role, but I'm opposed to low-fat processed foods, meaning that they've gone through a lot of processes to turn it into white flour and this and that, and you know, a lot of, you know what processing is. You take the original foods that are grown and you turn it into candy or something, sugar. That's wrong. Even oil, olives. Olives are unprocessed, but olive oil is highly processed. So let's keep up with this. But don't, what do they say, throw the baby out with the baby wash? We know the correct information about metabolism, so don't throw out the concept of whole natural foods unprocessed. They can even have a good amount of fat if it's an almond, nut, seed, or avocado, because the fiber's attacked and slows the absorption of the fat and the glucose and the protein at the rate the body needs. So let's go further.
Because they're not using the fat as a buffer for insulin. And that's why even the ice cream recipe that I have is that the heavy cream, look at heavy cream is 4%, okay? That's low. It doesn't stimulate insulin. So it's not gonna destroy the set point. It's not gonna create a problem. Now you can eat too much of it, but the point is that it's not gonna be, the importance of getting rid of it is very, very minimal.
Okay, wait a minute. So he's saying you could eat a whole heavy cream ice cream and it's not gonna throw off your set point. I don't know of anyone who can eat a little teaspoon of ice cream. I mean, you know, the point where you like salted, roasted seeds and, you know, you eat a small handful and then you end up eating the whole bag of potato chips or salted seeds and nuts. But worse, ice cream. I've seen people go through a whole half a gallon of ice cream. It's addicting. So for him to say that people are going to be able to control themselves eating whole fat ice cream, and then what fat does to the insulin long term, and what it does within less than 2 weeks to the blood sugar levels, not good advice. Sorry, Dr. Berg, but I disagree with you severely here. Let's go further.
Okay, so it's much more important to avoid the higher insulin things, but check this out. Egg yolk, 15%. That's pretty low. But look at the egg, the whole egg, no, I'm sorry, the egg whites is 55%. How many people do you know that just do egg whites thinking they're doing themselves some good and they're not doing the egg yolk? The egg yolk is much better for weight loss. If we combine the egg yolk with the egg whites, we get the whole egg, it brings it down to 21%.
Wow, it's kind of confusing for you to hear this, but he's saying that the egg whites has a 55% insulin index, and he's advocating eating the whole egg or even egg yolk is better than the egg white. That's very confusing, especially because diabetics usually die of heart attack because the high cholesterol in the eggs has clogged their arteries. They die of they have amputated limbs because the blood vessels to the circulation is so plugged up with atherosclerotic plaques, and they lose their eyesight. Again, the arteries to the eyes are blocked. This is sad. I'll never forget Charles he was a dean of PCC, Pasadena College, years and years ago. I was a physical therapist around 1978-79, working through USC and the hospitals and learning as an intern at that time. And it was really sad because I remember they fed him bacon and eggs every morning, and he had severe diabetes, and they amputated one of his legs. And I was a physical therapist, and I'm trying to figure out, well, how do I help him to walk with the one leg? And then that didn't last long. In the room smelled of stench of flesh because his flesh was rotting, and they amputated the other leg. I never forgot that. It was the most painful experience of my life as a health professional to experience what was going on, and we couldn't control what the patients were being fed in the hospitals. And the same foods that they serve in the hospitals is what they serve at the Holiday Inns. The cooks and the training, there's no aspect. You go to Rush Hospital where there's 14 cardiologists with William Kim, the former cardiologist of the American Cardiology Association, and he's all plant-based, oil-free, exercise, and all 14 of his cardiologist physicians are teaching the same thing. That's what Dr. Berg needs to learn. He needs to meet these doctors. I'll debate him openly on YouTube any day. I'll offer $1,000 to Berg to debate me if he wants. I'll offer that anyone who watches this, kind of like my physical fitness challenge, I don't know if that even makes sense to offer money. Let's just say I'm open to an open debate. I'm not afraid because I think Berg and I have a difference of opinion.
So by adding fat with a meal, you're actually helping the situation. Now, it is true, when you go through ketosis, you could be burning your own your dietary fat and not your own fat, but don't be afraid to consume whole things.
Oh, wow. He's just saying, if you're on ketosis and you're eating a fatty meal, that it's possible you're gonna consume the fat you ate instead of the fat on your body. Well, it is a big problem because tracers show that that fat that you consume goes right to your fat storage cells, even though you may be losing weight. Why do you lose weight on ketosis? Because there's so much water dehydration. All the excess protein and fat, the fat particularly, has to use a lot of water to be digested. So people get dehydrated on those diets. They're not losing fat rapidly, as he's implying. You can lose weight, but watch how many people gain it back, as opposed to if you do this comparison, the three comparisons that I stated at the beginning to measure insulin, glucose, and triglycerides, plant-based oil-free diet compared to keto diet, high fat, or Atkins, high protein, high fat, or you go on the Western diet, bar none. If I get 1,000 people enroll in this study, I guarantee you, you're gonna have a 90% success rate, but we're gonna have to add hypnosis because you're all too like conditioned to believe that protein and fat is so good for you. We're gonna have to help condition you, but so long as you follow my neuro reprogramming course on the fat loss and fitness, we can condition enough people and get a large scale study. I'll be happy to help fund that study and even offer products as part of it at no extra charge for the people enroll in the study. Let's go further.
Don't go lean at all, okay? Don't be afraid to use some butter. Don't be afraid to use some of these products. So look at this, we got pecans, very, very low. Bacon, 9%. See, in your mind, you're probably like, well, I need some lean bacon. No, you don't, you want the fattier bacon.
Oh my gosh, he says we want the fattier bacon? 9% of this so-called insulin index? And pecans are okay, 5%. I'd agree, pecans are great for you. Don't overeat them, but eat a small handful, soak them overnight preferably so you get rid of the anti-insulin property. But whole fat bacon, really?
Because the leaner the protein, the more it spikes insulin.
Oh, he's saying because the leaner the protein, the more it spikes insulin. So now he's criticizing lean protein. I don't want you to eat lean animal protein. I want you to eat plant-based, whole food, unprocessed proteins, the protein that's naturally present in the sweet potato, in the fruits, in the vegetables, in the broccoli. That will solve your problem, not what Berg is saying. I'm sorry I'm getting so enthusiastic and what might appear to be upset, but I've seen people die in the hospital on these matters and I want it to come to a stop.
Peanut butter, 11%, cheese, 15%, turkey, 23%, berries, 47%. Look at beef, 51%.
So he's saying berries are bad for you at 47%, but he's saying that it's fine to eat cheese at 15% and beef at, well, he's saying beef is 51%. So he's finally admitting one of these foods is bad for you. Let's go, let's see what he says.
So these people that do the Atkins diet, let's say they do it the first time, it works. The second time, it doesn't really work as well. The third time, it doesn't work at all. Why? Because dieting slows the metabolism, it destroys the set point, and they're actually increasing their insulin. Not as bad as a sugar person, but that's really what happens.
So he just criticized the Atkins diet because not only is it high in fat, high in protein, he says it destroys the insulin. And then he made another comment there that I think was relevant or important. Let's see. He's just saying that basically you got to go on this kind of strange high-fat diet without excess protein. But okay, let's hear.
look at apple, 75%, low-fat yogurt, 76%, banana, 84%, whole wheat bread, 96%, baked beans, 100%.
Okay, wow. So I'll put out this challenge. The foods that he says on the chart there that the insulin metabolism, the insulin index, specifically, if you ate a diet of berries, apples, which he says is bad for you at 75%, bananas at 84%, and potatoes 121%, and what was the other item? Let's just start with that. I guarantee if you ate a diet for a year, and you could live off a diet of potatoes, bananas, apples, berries, it may not be so enjoyable, but you could live healthy-wise off a diet like that. I know a guy who ate mostly 10 or 20 potatoes a day, and at the end of 2 years, he had lost and reached his goal weight through John McDougall. I met him, and he does this really cool talk about he's the spud man. But the point is, I've seen this time and again, those all those foods, berries, apples, potatoes have a good source of fiber, bananas. Now there's higher source of fiber like beans I'd throw in there, but he didn't really comment on beans. I don't see those. But I'll put that any day of the week for a year against a group that eats butter, olive oil, coconut oil, avocado, what's the other thing? Bacon, full fat bacon, whole eggs, and what else is he throwing in there that's good for you? Well, that's it, right? I'll take that challenge any day and we'll see what comes up on the real study.
Potatoes, 121%. I'm going to give you a download. You can download this page in the download section so you have a whole list of this, and I will also share in the extra section some food plans to show you what food you should be eating, just to take it one step further, okay? Now, so I'm just bringing your awareness up that there are foods that are messing you up that are not necessarily sugars, okay? And I want to show you next this one little point here, which is very, very, very important. And I know I kind of spent a lot of time getting to this point, but this is the most important point of this whole presentation. Okay, so if high levels of insulin over a period of time cause insulin resistance, then what happens is we have breakfast, lunch, and dinner, right? So here's the problem. When we eat, even the hormones in our digestive tract spike insulin. Boom. Okay, so we know we're going to get rid of the sugar and all that, and that's great. But if you snack in between the meals, if you're snacking, even with healthy things, okay, you're spiking the insulin. So we never have a chance to correct insulin resistance. So you must shoot for 3 meals a day or 2. Not to lower calories, because we're going to increase some fat, but simply to correct the insulin resistance. Now, how do you know if you have insulin resistance? Well, all those symptoms. If you have belly fat, if you you're going to have a fatty liver. If you have a fatty liver, you're going to have insulin resistance. If you have insulin resistance, you're going to have a fatty liver. If you have fatty liver, you're going to have visceral fat around here. So it's all kind of connected. So the point is that you want to shoot for only doing 3 meals a day, okay? That's number one. But here's the thing. Some people, when they get up in the morning, are not hungry. So don't eat. Even though the breakfast is the most important, your breakfast might be delayed until lunch. If you're not hungry in that morning, don't consume any food. Only eat when you're hungry. This is a lie to state that you need 6 meals a day. It's just going to screw things up. So we don't eat until we're hungry, and then we eat, okay? Now, if you want a little snack, let's say sugar-free chocolate or whatever, you can eat that right at the end of the meal, but not in the middle of the meals, not between meals. If you are so hungry and ravenously craving between meals, then we have to increase a little bit more food during the meal itself, specifically fat, low glycemic fat, okay?
Okay. He goes into great length, which is kind of a forerunner to what I believe he will term and others will term intermittent fasting. And he's saying, eat only 2 meals a day. Don't eat breakfast if you're not hungry. And I'm going to tell you that if you're not hungry, I agree. Because if you're so overweight, you got excess calories, even from the meal the night before. Trust me, fat will flow around the blood like triglycerides for 12 hours or longer. Eat when you're hungry, but that, if you do get a little hungry, not ravenous, but you're just a little weak or empty, snack and eat small amounts of vegetables and fruit and just kind of see if you're hungry. And do what the Japanese call harihashibu. Eat up to where you're 80% satisfied and then stop. And if you're still hungry, like he says, go ahead and have another snack or another meal. But big soups, big salads, vegetables, fill your digestive tract up with fiber. So it sends a signal to your brain that you're satisfied and hungry. That will allow you, like Colleen did at the beginning of the story, where she was able to stay on the program for a full year. Then 20 years later, she was able to stay on this program as I have. And the most important thing I want to show you is this particular finding. So this journal that was published in Psychology Today, what's your fat cell number? And let's see, here we go. August 12th, 2018, fairly new publication. And it says by Berette Brogard, and she's a PhD. She goes on to say, the biggest secret of your natural slim friends is they consume far fewer calories than you think, but they stay slim not only because of their low calorie intake, but also because of their lower fat cell number. It's huge to understand this because studies have shown that obese and overweight individuals have a greater number of fat cells than naturally slim people. This is the key. Understand, fat cells shrink in size, but the number of fat cells they have does not decrease. When fat cells die, like cells do, the body simply creates new ones in its effort to keep the number constant. So an obese person who loses weight will still have more fat cells than the person who never gained weight. So the greater number of fat cells in a formerly obese people may be a factor in their tendency to regain the weight they lost. The same amount of fat is distributed across a larger number of fat cells versus a small number of fat cells has the same weight and volume. But fatter fat cells produce more of the hormone leptin, which puts the body in a fat burning mode and makes us less hungry. So a smaller number of fat cells protects against weight gain. When you have large numbers of fat cells, you have many fat cells with less fat in each. Smaller fat cells have an increased fat filling drive. They favor fat storage and cause us to feel hungry. So when a person with a large number of fat cells loses weight, this results in less fat in each cell, and this makes the body fight to gain the weight back. That is the real secret. You're not going to be able to trick your body. You were born with your genetics. If you have that fat storage and you have that pear shape, or what's the other one, the apple shape, which is kind of the mid-girth body fat or the lower body fat, you can beat that genetics. But the only way I've ever seen over a 40-year career of people who have lost the weight and kept it off, including myself, is to have a plan that's sensible, that is consistent with what our primitive relatives were able to sustain perfect weight. Look at Asian cultures. Look at cultures that sustain beautiful body shape throughout their life. Some of them have the genetics to have more fat cells, but when they come to our country, they get really fat. When they come to the UK, very fat. The Western diet is what they have in common with being overweight, because those fat cells, they fill up with as much fat and they increase in number and they gain. The only way, in my experience and in my ability to share with you, is control the hormones, the insulin, as I've described, plant-based whole foods, eating only when you're hungry in portions. And it could be one meal, three meals, six meals, eight meals a day. It's whatever it is, but don't overeat. But if you do overeat, eat large volumes of salads and soups that have no added oil. So it fills you up and there's not many calories. So it's never going to cause you to gain weight, and that excess fat won't go to your fat storage cells. I hope I didn't go too fast on that, but this is critical. So intermittent fasting is only responsible, that is, people have to starve themselves and feel deprived and hungry because they eat too much fat in their meals on a high protein or a high fat keto diet or a high paleo diet. A high plant-based oil-free diet will solve that for you, and exercise you must include. But let's go further, because this last point has to do with estrogen dominance, and I totally believe Dr. Berg's right on this point.
And what that means is you have insulin resistance. That's why you have almost like a blood sugar issue there. And then the same thing at night. Don't consume past your dinner, okay? Now, some of my clients are doing, they're not hungry in the morning. They eat a big lunch and they eat a dinner and they're done, two meals. And that's incredible because you're doing intermittent fasting for the next period of time. So you're gonna heal the insulin resistance and you're gonna lower your set point. Me, I have to eat a breakfast and then a lunch and I barely will have a dinner. I might have a small little kale shake and I'm done. So it's like 2.5 meals a day. So you can do that as well. But the key is don't snack at night, okay? You can drink tea and things like that, all right? So, and then the last section, I'm gonna give you a series of additional things that you can do to improve insulin resistance. Okay, so intermittent fasting is a very important thing to implement, but you don't necessarily have to go the whole day without eating. You can start with three meals and then go down to two. If you wanna alternate and do every other day, you know, skip a meal, that's totally fine. The key is, as you do this, you're gonna control your sugars better between meals and you won't have to eat as much because you're, think about it, when you're fasting, you're living off your own fat. If you have reserve to burn, then might as well burn that up. When you hit your goal, you don't necessarily have to do fast anymore. It's not starving your body. It's basically getting your body just more efficiently to switch over to fat burning and not burn your sugar. Because if you actually can't make it to the next meal, that means that you're just burning sugar. So we have to improve this. So there's several things we can do to lower insulin, okay? Number one, apple cider vinegar helps blood sugars tremendously. So you can consume that with a meal. If you don't like it, you can consume it as a pill. But if you're gonna do it in water, a teaspoon per glass, okay? Fermented foods are much better for insulin than anything else. So fermented cabbage, sauerkraut, that's all really good because it has vinegar in it as well. High potassium food, that would be all the vegetables. Now, here's the problem. When we do this, when we lower insulin, you're gonna be living off your fat and you're gonna have a lot more fat being burned, which means that your liver has to process a lot more fat burning. If you do this without eating enough vegetables, you're gonna end up with a fattier liver. So there is no choice. You have to consume larger amounts of greens. You can blend them, you can drink them, but you need to consume that to keep the fat flush from the liver. That's the only way you're gonna get rid of the fatty liver. Okay, so then we got high potassium foods, that's vegetables. Vitamin B1 will decrease the need for insulin. That would be a nutritional yeast, okay? Make sure you don't buy the synthetic version though. Fiber, it's also in my adrenal day formula too. We have B1, that's a natural one.
Okay. So he's saying use apple cider vinegar. I'm not opposed to that. It's fine. It's kind of a strong taste. Maybe a teaspoon or a tablespoon is about most anyone could handle. There's probably some other benefits to it because somehow the acidic might create a little bit of a pH balance. Surprisingly, when it's taking something acidic, the body wants to create a little more alkalinity. There's a lot of theories about it. I'm not opposed to it. It has no fat in it. It's fine, go ahead and use it. Whether it actually stabilizes insulin, okay, show me the science on that. It's probably there, and I respect that. Fermented foods, sure. And he's saying the best, like cabbage, like kimchi, like sauerkraut, but those are vegetables. And fermented, sure, you benefit from the probiotic aspect of it. High potassium, he says eat lots of vegetables. That's why Berg's diet works, because he's telling you to eat so many vegetables. I think somewhere he said 7 to 14 servings of vegetables. I wouldn't even limit it that. 20, 30, 40 servings of vegetables. Because vegetables on the lower spectrum of this caloric intake, you can have 20 servings at 30 calories per cup. On a net average, that's barely 600 calories. Everyone's gonna lose weight on that approach. This is what I advocate. And certainly if you add fruit into there, there's rich potassium there. He's not opposed to that, but he's squeamish about fruit because other keto people are somehow afraid of fruit. And you know, just look at the science about fruit. And now he's admitting fiber is needed. Well, fiber, sometimes vegetables are like high in lettuce and there's a lot of water and there's a little bit of fiber. The fiber is gonna come better from, say, a cup of beans, which is very rich in fiber. Just cook them long enough because there's a lot of people worried about the lectins. So just cook them long enough, but let's finish. So that's a good summary and my comment to that, why his program does work is the first five steps of what he's teaching, which is right in line with that, what I agree with and teach.
Fiber, like if you're gonna do a choice between a kale shake with the fiber, like a blended versus a juice, It's better to do the fiber because the fiber buffers the insulin, okay? So we want fiber-rich foods. Celery is great.
Okay, so again, he'll say eat the kale salad without oils added to it. Use this fat-free salad dressing so it comes out good and is not high in sugar or anything like that, as opposed to like a kale juice or something. In my case, I'd say an apple instead of apple juice. So we both agree fiber is essential to stabilizing insulin and blood sugar. But now he says something I don't agree with regarding fat.
Fat. Consume more pure fats. Why? It's not that we're telling you that fat's going to necessarily cause you to lose a lot of weight, but it's very sustaining between the meals. And it has no effect on insulin. It's going to help correct it. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to get you to eat enough fat so you can go longer without having to eat. The reason why we're going longer is so we can reverse the flow and not have sustained persistent insulin, but have like a low insulin situation. Because if you have diabetes and you constantly have high sugar, well, if you don't eat, you're not going to have high sugar. So guess what? This is really good for a diabetic. I mean, this is how you reverse diabetes. Because what is insulin resistance? It's a type 2 diabetes.
Oh, wow. This is not really good for a diabetic. Eating more fat is the worst thing a diabetic could do. He's somehow convinced that fat itself stabilizes insulin and blood sugar. It's quite the opposite. In study after study, that's well-controlled studies, when they actually infuse fat directly in the bloodstream, Ferber and his team showed immediate elevation of blood sugar and throwing off the insulin levels. In study after study, very high fat diets disrupt the insulin metabolism and lead to diabetes. Quite the opposite, a high fiber, high vegetable, no added oil diet, but you get the fat naturally present in the fruits and vegetables and beans and peas. A little bit of fat within the nuts and seeds in small quantity, that's the diet that cures and reverses diabetes. And we know this to be true in the largest scale study ever done on diabetics at the Pritikin Longevity Center, published in the medical literature. And you can look in the show notes about this, but this is so well described. Do not take this advice of eating more fat to cure diabetes. It's quite the opposite.
But you can have a version of it. It doesn't come like this. You can have a small version of it that's not, it's like a pre-diabetes situation. Okay, so lowering cortisol, that's with the stress, reducing the stress, doing my adrenal techniques, all that, removing body stress is important because cortisol releases glucose, which increases insulin, and reducing estrogen.
Wait a minute. He's saying by lowering cortisol, reduce stress, that cortisol increases insulin and glucose specifically. Actually, cortisol and insulin-like growth factor in a proper regulated area push glucose into the cells. Insulin-like growth factor, what does that mean? It's a derivative of the liver stimulated by human growth hormone. And we also know that cortisol itself is one of the main stress-fighting hormones. It protects us from stress. Read the book Safe Uses of Cortisol by William McKinley Jeffries, who originally wrote the book Safe Uses of Cortisone, but people mistook the whole idea because of synthetic prednisone, which is just synthetic and just too strong and does cause weight gain in some people. But used over a protracted period, understanding the regulation of cortisol, yes, you do want to manage stress. Yes, you do want to take a quality product that helps to control the adrenal glands and support healthy cortisol release without having to depend on adrenaline. So look into the product Adrenal DMG, look into the use of the product Adrenal Cytoplex, get outdoors in the daylight, get your healthy levels not too high of cortisol, but not too low. Because most people have adrenal burnout and can't produce enough cortisol, and they're fatigued, they're tired, they crave sugars, they're just out of control, they're addictive nature of people. You need to understand my work on cortisol and Dr. Terry Hertog, who's probably one of the world experts on cortisol, as he's one of the world experts on thyroid. And if you read this $500 book, Atlas of Endocrinology for Hormone Therapy, you read his other textbooks, it'll become very clear to you. And in my playlist with Dr. Hertog, Dr. Sangeeta Patty, Dr. Kathleen Geringer, we have such a clear explanation of how important healthy adrenal levels, not excess. And cortisol got a bad name because of the drugs prednisone, that even 5 milligrams lingers in the body too long. The body has to produce 40 milligrams of cortisol, not these harsh, strong drugs. Now he's talking about my favorite subject is estrogen.
If you have too much of it. So if your period is heavy, we can do the technique on the ovaries. If you're taking estrogen, not a great idea because it's going to cause you to gain weight.
Yeah, so he's right. Taking excess estrogen, particularly the synthetic estrogens, can cause one to gain weight. Birth control pills can cause women to gain weight. You want to use a product like DIM-259 to help manage the bad estrogens and clear them out of your system. The metabolism of estrogen is the key here, not necessarily suppressing estrogens, but converting them to safer forms so the body can actually lose weight. DIM-259 is a fabulous product to help you to manage your body weight. And also using a product like the Slim Blend, which is rich in plant proteins, vegetables, no added sugar. It tastes good. It's got a vanilla flavor. You're going to love this product. And in conjunction for those of you who do initially have kind of an appetite that's out of control, we have this product, Lean and Fit, which has various herbs that increases metabolism. So during your low points, it gets you out wanting to exercise and feel good and have energy. But if you're kind of sensitive to any kind of stimulant and you can't handle coffee or caffeine, particularly if your adrenals are burned out, then do the more subtle, the what's called methyl donors. And we have that in Neuro Inspire product.
Sleeping more is going to lower insulin. Exercising is going to lower insulin.
Yeah, exercise is going to lower and control and manage insulin. I totally agree. And then he said we talked about vegetables. So let's hear the conclusion here.
We talked about vegetables, okay? So I gave you a lot of things that you can do. Go ahead and start with the intermittent fasting of at least 3 meals and no snacks, and then try to go 2 over time, okay? And watch what happens. Your set point is going to go down. This is how you fix a broken metabolism.
So in summary, he's saying this is how you fix a broken metabolism. Take our hormone quiz at DelgadoProtocol.com in the show notes. Learn about what I've shared with you. This video, I believe, is one of the most important videos you'll ever hear on this subject, the absolute truth about how to manage the short-term and the long-term result to lose this body fat permanently, reach your goal weight, and keep it off for a lifetime as I have, and as tens of thousands of other successful individuals who have attended my seminars and events, and I've monitored some of the early pioneers that work with me back when I was with the Pritikin Longevity Center and other individuals who to this day look back on that turning point. John McDougall and his successful clients, Joel Furman and his successful clients, Caldwell Esselstein, Dean Ornish. We are all what's called lifestyle medicine, and we want to take you to that highest level and then learn about the balance of hormones with the trainers that I've worked with, learn about the incredible benefits of exercise, fit at any life with Lee Haney, and how he eats a very high carbohydrate, 500 grams of carbohydrate a day to balance and protect and have a protein sparing effect. This information and my original book is now available in a download, Weight Loss and Energy Now, as part of my elite coaching program, and the original book, How to Look Great and Feel Sexy, with the recipes and the guidelines. I am so enthusiastic that I want you to be successful. And the first 100 people that enroll in our coaching program, our regular charge, we're going to give this program to the first 100 people who enroll and take advantage by putting something in the engagement notes. We're going to send you, after we, if you can drop us an email, just look into our notes of admin@delgadoprotocol.com, and we'll include you in this special motivation online course, Fat Loss and Fitness. We'll include whatever the going rate is, because the rate changes depending on the specials going on. We'll include you for the first 100 people, not for whatever the going rate is, as I said. We'll include a show link to you, absolutely free. Take that offer, because over the course of 1 year, we're going to update that course. We're going to include content and information that will guide you to be so successful that I'm here as your guide to help you to be the healthiest you've ever been. Live long, be well, be strong. Dr. Nick here. Thank you, Dr. Berg. You're amazing. And now we've taken your information to the next level. Join me. And I look forward to that debate someday with you, Eric Berg, so that you and I can hash through the science either behind closed doors or in public. I'm ready for you. Let's go.